You're now watching Boomsies on the Bet Rivers Network.
What's up, everybody? Baseball season's here, and the solar eclipse is headed our way. I saw an Instagram video just before the podcast where it's got like that AI voice talking. A lot of the AI voices really annoy me. And it was like, things to watch for during the solar eclipse. You will notice a change in temperature. Really? When the entire sun gets blocked out, the temperature's gonna drop? Thanks for that info. Oh, I shouldn't swear right off the top. Beep that out, Tim. Boomsies. More great chat with him yesterday on the telephone. Just moved back to Nashville. Dive into the music scene. And he revealed a very interesting story. We were talking about Prince. And Nate's like, oh yeah. He came into one of my shows one night. I'm like, wait a second. Prince saw you perform? And he said, after the fact, I discovered Prince doesn't like to hear other people play his music. And Nate did his own version of Purple Rain when Prince came in. And Prince, he gone. Well, he's gone from this earth, but he was also gone from that show. Nate, poor guy. Why are you gonna play one of his songs here? Yeah. Prince, come back. Oh, well. That's what I'd do, too. Try and impress him. The biggest, easiest way to impress someone is with a compliment. No bigger compliment to an artist than playing one of their songs. So you'd think. Sorry for swearing off the top. I'm Dan, this is Boomsies, and we're glad you're here. I hope you felt the rebirth that I felt with the start of the Major League Baseball season. You don't even have to be a fan of the sport to get a sense of what opening day means. Blank slate, everyone, zeros across the board. You picture that in your mind and it's like, that's just brilliance in numerical form. All just waiting, and those goose eggs waiting to get cracked open. Everyone has hope. Everyone can have the greatest season of their lives. Everyone can win the division on opening day. That's why I love the sport of baseball. And we're sitting here in the aftermath of the Toronto Blue Jays getting no hit by the Houston Astros. If you've seen clips of the no-hitter, you will now know that no-hitter was thrown in the ugliest uniforms in the history of baseball. I didn't know where they got those things. Maybe to distract people from the pounding on garbage cans. It was the earliest no-hitter in Major League Baseball history. April 1st. And I went back and looked at all the no-hitters that have taken place in April. Because I want to get a sense. I wanted to offer Jays fans some hope. And it's I'll tell you this. It did not start off well. I went back to 1979 because before then, I don't know what. And I'm born in 75, but before, like in 19... We're looking at 1910 stats. The guy selling hot dogs was pitching in some of those games. They probably didn't even have baseballs most games. Look at the highlights. Oh, it's tough to find highlights from 1910. When was the TV invented? Like, when did we first get moving pictures? That's something Google can tell you.
TV and moving pictures are two different things, but TV started in like the 40s.
Okay. When's the first movie pictures? Like the silent films.
I would say late 19th century, early 20th, probably, I'm guessing.
Okay.
Google says 1888.
I call bullshit.
Look at that.
18. Here's the weird thing about those movies from way back when, because they now colorize them. They'll say, here's a New York street from 1901. And it's better video quality than stuff from 1970. I digress. We've discussed this before. Anyway, I went back to 1979. And since 1979 till now, counting Monday's no-hitter, there have been 18 no-hitters in April. But I'm only going to look at 17 because this one, we don't know how the Jays are going to finish up. But of those 17 teams that were no-hit in April, dating back to 1979, 12 of those teams finished last or second last in their division. But I will give you this glimmer of hope, Blue Jays fans. Two of those teams that were no-hit of the 17 won their division. And then two others finished second. So all is not lost. There is historical evidence that getting no hit in April can be brutal for your season, but cannot ruin everything. One game does not a season make. I look back to, it was either the first year, the first World Series year, or the second. And in one of those seasons, the Jays lost a game like 23-7 or something like that. Some crazy, ungodly number was scored against them. Yet they went on to win the World Series. If you jumped on Blue Jays Twitter or X after that no-hitter, I hope Ross Atkins didn't. Fifth game of the season, and people were laying it on, saying this is the team that Ross Atkins sat with all winter and was content with. It's five games in. It's a blip. Don't let it ruin your season. Come on now. I still have faith. Just seeing Justin Turner bat explode on the weekend. Give me some of that. We've got Joey Votto now doing fielding drills as he comes back from an ankle injury he suffered in spring. I did read some bad news about that. The article said that Joey Votto, okay, he's going to do fielding, work his way up to hitting in spring training down on in Dunedin. And his entry onto the major league team all depends on Daniel Vogelbach. Vogelbach. What are we going with? Vogelbach. I'm going to go with. If he hits the leather off the baseball, Joey Votto will probably get his outright release to find another team. I didn't like reading those words. And I don't want Daniel Vogelbach to struggle. So we're in a conundrum here. I just hope there's a different avenue for Vogelbach to succeed and Votto still get the call. So the Votto dream is still alive. The Jays dream is still alive. Don't give up hope. It's too early. I did want to, I like giving you viewing tips for your Netflixes, your Prime Video, your, I don't have the Apple TV, Disney. I never watch anything on there. You don't need it anyway. Because on Netflix, it's in the top 10 in Canada. It's being discussed a lot. Guy Ritchie's The Gentleman. Netflix series. I believe it's 6 episodes. We started that Friday night. We finished that Saturday night. I told my buddy Sully. I was on the phone with him. I'm like, hey, we're just finishing The Gentleman. He's like, any good? I said, Sully, you have no idea. He says, okay, give it a shot. Next day, he finishes it. It is a show in which it does not stop. And I base a show on how it grips me by the anxiety it gives me. I was filled with anxiety, in which I couldn't turn it off because I needed to see the situation resolved to give me peace of mind. Brilliantly acted, brilliantly shot, storyline amazing. 5 Boomsies out of 5 on The Gentleman. Could not recommend anymore. And then this weekend, typical, when you're a parent, your entire life is trying to find something for the kids to eat. Your entire parenting life is, oh man, I don't want to go to the grocery store. It's got to be something here. And Tim, you're a big fan of cooking shows. Tell me if this show exists. And I know what you're going to think of. You're going to think, okay, that's Chopped. No, this is not Chopped. You aren't given specific items. Here's a rubber band, a shoelace, and a stick of bubble gum. And then people have a full pantry to take from. And they're like, oh, this is bubblegum infused tilapia with a hint of rubber band.
That is the grossest thing I've ever heard in my life.
This is not that show. Here is my show proposal, because I excel at this. We're approaching dinner time. You don't have a set thing to make for dinner. So you have to hodgepodge a dinner in which people will look at it, not be repulsed, eat it, and be pleasantly, if not extremely, satisfied. I did that this weekend, in which I'm like, okay, these kids, okay, I got to make this happen. So you go into quarterback mode. You're going through the plays in your mind. You're looking at items. And I came together with a great meal where the flavors were bursting. And I sat there proud of myself, and I said, I would like to see this cooking show in which you're given a fridge and a pantry where it's not like empty, but it's like a can of corn. There's a frozen pork tenderloin. There's like half of a bell pepper. And these are items that I was working with. There's half of a red onion. Stores are closed because it's a holiday. So that's another added thing in there. And you're like, okay, it's game time. Who can come up with the best meal with those limited pantry items? So not a stock pantry. You're just making do with what you got. Tim, does that show exist right now?
I don't know if that show exists, but usually there's at least one challenge on Top Chef that's something along those lines where they have a very limited pantry or, you know, fridge access to ingredients that they have to come up with something.
There used to be a show on Netflix that was something similar to that, where it was like create a meal using leftovers. It was like best leftovers ever. I don't know if it's still on.
Leftover meals? That's easy because you've already got something created and you're just bringing it back to life and then adding something. That's easy. Everyone can do that. I'm talking from scratch, limited items. Guys, I think we might have to start a new show.
It could be a Bachelor spinoff because that's what Bachelors actually do, right?
Nah, Bachelors just go out. Bachelors just say, I'm just going to get skip the dishes. And I would do that, except I find everything that gets delivered from God knows whatever restaurant, it all tastes the same. I don't know if the pandemic has done that to me or if you feel the same. But I could order from an Italian restaurant. I could order from a Chinese food restaurant. I could order from Boston Pizza. I don't order from there, but hey, because I'm not paying $40 for a pizza, which is the price of a Boston pizza. Anyway, any of those items arrive at my doorstep, I'm blindfolded. I couldn't tell you where it's from. All tastes the same. That's why I like to cook food in my kitchen, because it has flavor. We're going to brainstorm on a name. We're going to pitch this bad boy to Netflix. Have ourselves a nice Netflix deal. Because they do have provisions under the CRTC in which they have to have some type of Canadian content. Do they not, Tim?
I know it's pretty dicey. I think they have to carry some content. Yeah, I think so.
Oh, and there's the name of the show, Tim. Pretty Dicey. Or not. Speaking of streaming services, this came as massive news to me. Our guys checked to see it wasn't an April Fool's joke. But Amazon could be taking over the entire Monday night NHL package from Rogers. So you'd be watching NHL games on Amazon Prime. The rumor is Amazon would take over Monday nights for the remaining 2 years of Rogers' deal with the NHL. It's long been known that this extremely long Rogers NHL contract, at the back end of it, Rogers is not making money. So this is Amazon not sending them a lifeline. It's just Rogers saying, okay, this is going to help us financially. Well, Amazon is treading into new waters. Because if memory serves me correct, gentlemen, the NHL has never been on any of the streaming services to this point as far as live games go.
Weren't they doing something with Disney Plus and like animated games? I haven't watched it, but I feel like I heard something like that.
Yeah, the Big City Greens game. Remember I texted you about that, Dan. Show I sent you the screen grabs.
I didn't know if that was happening. Tim, like a lot of our texts, or if Andrew sends me an article, I say,
yeah, I know.
What's it say?
Yeah, you can't be bothered to click.
No, I can be bothered, Tim, but I am so in the moment of my life. I don't want to find my glasses. I don't want to get, I just don't want to do it.
No
I don't want
to have to read it. No one said you had to read it right there and then. You
no, that's how my anxiety works, Tim. When I get a text, I deal with it right there and then. I don't put it on the back burner because I'll forget.
You say, I'll read this later, and then hit send.
Can't do it, Tim.
Well, then that's an issue for you.
Just like if someone says, I need to talk to you. How about this afternoon? I need that conversation to happen right now. I cannot wait till the afternoon.
But anyway, yes, did the Big City Green game on Disney Plus, at least in Canada. I don't know if they did it in Canada last year, but they did it in Canada this year. But that's the only live game I know of on streaming services in Canada.
So with this Amazon Prime deal, would it start this year before the playoffs or for the playoffs?
No, I think it's for the last 2 years of the contract.
Okay, because that would piss off a lot of people. Imagine that. You're trying to find the Leaf. They wouldn't sell off the Leafs. They'd be selling off American Series 100% for the playoffs.
Well, it's the Monday night package, though. That's always at least one Canadian team, right?
Okay.
Because that, like last night, the Leafs were Monday night.
Okay. We knew this was going to happen. Live sports is what's keeping the cable industry in business. Yet here we have a cable provider giving entry to Amazon Prime. Which kind of, when you think about it, well, why are you letting them get started so people know where it is and they show people that they can do it and test out the waters to see if there is a market for them to carry these games, because the new deal will be up in 2 years and Amazon Prime will have footing in which they have success or not. They have numbers and they can show the league, hey, we know how to do this. We have already done it for the last 2 years. Very odd when you think about it. Am I overthinking this? That the lifeblood of these cable networks, they're giving entry to someone who might put them out of business?
I mean, if they need money, they need money. It's, you know, let's not give them credit for looking too far down into the future.
All I know is year after year, you see the numbers come out, and I'm surprised more people every year aren't cutting the cable, because it's dropping significantly year over year. 10 years from now, it's going to be staggering how few people still have cable TV. And the cable industry knows this. They have to. The writing's on the wall. I wish them the best of luck. I never want anyone to lose their jobs, and hopefully everyone stays employed. That's all. Oh, crap. Speaking of streaming services, don't forget to check me out. Check me out, meow, every Monday on the Bet Rivers Players Club. What I do is hop on the old YouTubes at 1 Eastern, and I play slots. Now, I don't know how this would be confusing, but my good friend Andrew Perloff McLovin sent me a text on Monday afternoon. He's like, hey, I hopped onto your stream and you'll have to explain to me what was going on. So I was sitting there and I didn't follow up with him because I'm going to call him and discuss it. But I was playing slots. I wasn't like solving algebra problems or doing chemistry. I was hitting a button, hoping for everything to match up and winning money. Something leads me to believe Perloff, not a big Vegas guy. Hey, what's everyone doing here? We're gambling. What's that? We're trying to win money. How do you do that? So it's very easy. It's a very simple concept. I sit there, play the latest slots. Z Money and I shoot the shit. I actually have a ball doing it. It's our little Monday hangout. Why don't you join us every Monday, 1 Eastern? And then you can catch other people streaming every single weekday at 6 Eastern. It's the Bet Rivers Players Club, and it's a hoot as we dive into Boomsies Newsies with the one, the only, Z Money. April or March 31st, I believe, was the last day of the Roll Up the Rim. And every streaming session, I bring over a Tim Hortons, a drink, one for Andrew, one for myself. And my totals for Roll Up the Rim, I won 4 free coffees. I won a 3-month subscription to The Athletic. And on the final roll up, I won like 3 cents off a liter at some gas station. But Z Money is like many who couldn't be bothered. Z, why didn't you download the app? You just, like I said, couldn't be bothered?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I research the news every week for Boomsies Newsies, and I remember one time reading about some Tim Hortons app getting hacked or everyone's info getting out there. So,
now tell us, you also sent me an article. This is one of the ones where I had you explain it to me because I was driving or something. I'm like, give me the Kohl's notes. So some guy found a loophole in the Roll Up the Rim system. What was it?
Yeah, so this guy said he bought 20 medium hot waters and then told the people at Tim Hortons, don't actually make them, just charge me for them, I'll pay them. And so he was able to get whatever, you know, if that's 20 cents, he paid however much money. And then he got all the Roll Up the Rims and he made his money back times 10 by doing this a bunch of times and just winning a bunch of free stuff and only paying for hot waters that he didn't actually take.
Okay, so at first I thought he just said, give me a water, but he's actually paying for the cup. So I think that is a scam. That is a legit scam. These people aren't going to lose their jobs. They're like, hey, we rung it in on the till, because I'm sure with the Roll Up the Rim program, they have to account for every cup because they don't want people giving away sleeves of them. Although, that wouldn't even matter now. Hang on. That would matter because your spin or your roll-up thing is registered once you scan your app. Okay, so now I just figured it out. So yeah, they would scan his app and for those water purchases. And he didn't win anything big. He won the same as me, like an Athletic subscription. He won some donuts and some coffees. There was nothing major, though, right?
Yeah, no, nothing major. Just basically, he won a bunch of free food. So, I mean, it worked out for him.
Okay. Let's do it, bud. What do you got for us?
Well, I wanted to start with, I think, something that's going to be a little controversial. So, back on episode 101 of Boomsies, we touched on an internet poll for the greatest TV character of all time, which turned out to be Rowan Atkinson's Mr. Bean. So the same social media account polled their followers and asked them, what is the hardest sport to play? And the winner was very surprising to me. Soccer won. It beat out surfing in the finals with over 70% of the vote. So the poll went out to over 2.3 million people around the globe. And it was done in a bracket style. Do you think soccer is the hardest sport in the world?
No, I am now more convinced than ever. The site that does this poll is just trolling everyone. Because if there is a sport in the world in which an alien came here, or someone came out of a cave, never having to experience civilization, and you needed to teach them a sport within 10 minutes, soccer is the sport I would teach them. Ball on ground, point to it, and you swing your foot and kick it. There's soccer. Yet this poll determined that soccer is the hardest sport. Fuck off. Easiest sport, yes. And I did my top 5 of hardest sports to learn, to get good at, whatever you, however you want. You're starting from zero on these sports, so you've never played them. These are the hardest to start from ground zero. Cricket. That's a hard ball. Someone's throwing it at you. It's bouncing. You're trying to hit a wicket if you're the one throwing it. Like, you catch them with no glove. Number four, lacrosse. You try get out there and teach someone how to catch a ball with a lacrosse stick in 10 minutes. You want to teach them lacrosse or soccer? It's got to be done in 10 minutes. Which sport you picking? Everyone's picking soccer first. Number three is not really a sport people play, but if you've seen it, terrifying. Highlight. It's the one where you got the scoopy handled device. You whip the ball. People have died at this sport. Number three, hockey. If you're Canadian, you've either learned how to skate or taught someone how to skate. I guess if you've learned how to skate, then you've been taught. Anyway, you know what I'm saying. Extremely difficult. You're standing on ice, on freaking blades, on knives. Yet you say soccer's more difficult? Screw off! Oh no, did I mess up on this too? So I did cricket, lacrosse, high lie, hockey. Oh, I said hockey was number three. It's number two. Number one is surfing. I am horrible at lists because I make changes to them and I don't renumber them. So I either forget something or I put one too few on the list. So that's your order. Most difficult to least, surfing number one. You try stand up on a wave, on a board, in the ocean. Impossible. Number two was hockey. Number three was highlight. Number four is lacrosse. Number five is cricket. Good, we got five. Additions, subtractions to that list, Z Money.
I mean, any combat sport, I guess it's not difficult. I just don't want to get punched in the face, so... No, I think your list is pretty solid. I mean, maybe some horse racing or auto racing, because you're not really in
control.
Here's
the thing, because MMA made that list and we were having a discussion before the podcast began. Your human instinct for survival kicks in if you put someone in an octagon and you don't need to know any rules. You're just like, try not to get beat up. So you just go into survival mode. That's where the difficulty's taken out of MMA. While those other things, like catching a ball, learning how to skate, those things are difficult. You can't go into survival mode in those. You just have to have hand-eye coordination and have balance or not. So that's why I didn't include MMA, because of that reason.
Another story to get to. This one's closer to home in Toronto. Toronto City Council has officially decided to name the iconic space at Yonge and Dundas after the late Gord Downie, going with Gord Downie Square over the originally proposed, I hope I'm saying this correctly, Sankofa Square. So Sankofa Square was chosen to symbolize return to one's roots and moving forward. But after months of deliberation, Toronto residents were invited to vote on the final name, and Gord Downie Square is your winner.
No one's going to have a complaint with this. Unless people were backing the other one they wanted to be named. I know nothing about this. I just heard there's going to be a Gord Downie Square. And I hope that there's quietly, tragically hit plane in the square at all times. You walk through there. If you've never been, it's like a mini Times Square in downtown Toronto. Less busy, but a lot of lit up billboards in a space right next to the Eaton Center. Gord Downie, when I think about him saying, yeah, we're putting this thing in downtown Toronto, he'd be like, ah, man, couldn't you have like the horseshoe dance?
So
the hell was that?
That was me buzzing in. This
You scared the fuck out of me, Tim.
An editor's note on this blog TO story. This is an April Fool's post. As far as we were aware, there's no plans to honor Gord Downie by renaming Young and Dundas.
Stupid April Fools. That one got me.
Also, this big post time. Was written by Eileen Adamson, our new AI writer, and edited by a human.
That's a fucking horrible joke.
Yeah.
It's not funny.
Yeah. I don't know how to break this to you. No April Fool's joke is funny. Hmm.
Well, that's sad.
Tim, did we need the buzzer at the highest volume setting?
Yeah, I didn't change the volume. I just hit the button, man.
Oh, God. Oh, man. Okay, so what I was going to say was, Gord Downie would be mortified that a place in downtown, he's like, hey, can't you name a park after me? Like, put me in the out in nature. It would not offend him, but he'd be like, it's not really my vibe. Oh, you got screwed, Z-Money. You spent all day deciphering what was real and what wasn't, and they gotcha.
I can't stand April Fools. Can't stand all the made-up stories when I'm trying to come up with a rundown for new stories to talk about.
The only good one that I remember, the only good April Fools joke was, Tim, you'll remember this. So CFTO, which is the CTV station in Toronto, I didn't get any of the sports networks. We had an antenna, so we got like five channels. We got Chex TV, which was our local station. We got the CTV channel, we got Global, we got a Buffalo station, and then maybe another one. So whatever those channels gave me, that's all I got. So we watched Sportsline on Global, which was the Jim Taddy and Mark Hepscher. So you wanted your sports highlights, you watched that Monday to Friday. They also had on the weekends. But CFTO had a sports show on like Saturday mornings. It was like half hour to an hour. Tim, do you remember this show?
I do not.
Anyway. They had this show and they led off one of them. As a kid, you don't know what the calendar is. You don't know what day it is. And they lead off with the Toronto Blue Jays with a massive deal. They traded away like half the team, including like Tony Fernandez. And I remember running around the house, picking up the phone, calling friends saying, can you believe that this happened? I'm a massive Jays fan at this time. And then at the end of the show, they say, hey, we let off the show with this massive trade. Well, check your calendar. It's April 1st. And that is one of my earliest memories from being kicked in the gut. I'm like, you sons of bitches. What are you doing to me here? So April Fool's and April 1st left a bitter taste in my mouth because of that moment. And that's the only one in my mind that really worked. So I agree with you, Andrew. It's crap. Don't like it. And it's gone way too far now because of social media. Every platform, everyone trying to out April Fools the other person. And we're all fools in the end.
Also, with the way the world is right now, pretty much anything is believable.
Oh, 100%. Most headlines I see day to day, I'm like, what the fuck are we living in? How much is lettuce now? What? A pound of butter is $8? What the? Hey, Galen Wesson. We ain't going to be seeing him in any commercials anymore. He gone. He's hiding. Was very kitschy. It was cute when he was in the commercials talking about the president's choice items. That's not happening anymore. Unless he goes on to make fun of himself. But bye-bye, Galen. The only Galen we'll ever know. Because who names their kid Galen? That's all you got, Z-Money?
Yeah, that's all I got, because I don't know what's true and what's fake, so let's end there.
Okay. Well, it's true that it's early in the baseball season. It's true that we aren't even a week in. Don't let one game get you down. We got the most exciting time of the sports calendar coming up. With baseball season underway, NBA playoffs coming up, NHL Stanley Cup playoffs coming up, and the Masters. It is the greatest time to be alive. And the first flowers are blooming in the garden. Take a moment. Enjoy the flowers. Don't lose your eyeballs staring at the sun during the solar eclipse. There's no special powers with the solar eclipse. Every day the sun has the same powers. And every day if you look up at the sun for a long period of time, you can go blind. Just remember that. Hug someone you don't know who needs it. And be nice. It doesn't cost you anything. See you next week.
Welcome to Boomsies with Dan O'Toozy. Live from Orno in the heart of Ontario. Oh, baby, Boomsies.